Okay, so Farida ma'am is here. I think we can begin the session now.
Good morning, Farida ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. So, we'll begin the session today. Today, it's all going to be about changes around us, the chemical changes that are taking place. So, please pin yourself to the Educate lab. So you can see the presentation. Okay. So we're going to first begin with changes. So basically anything that is not going as per the current situation, we say that there is a change. Okay. If I will tell you all to tell me a few changes, you all will come up with a list of changes. You all will come up with changes like, let's say you have taken a wood and now you're carving it into a bat. Or then you're taking ice, you're taking milk and you're converting it into ice cream. That is also a change. Right now, there is a pandemic going on. So because of that pandemic going on, we are all in the house. That is also a change. So there are lots and lots of changes around us. Okay. We need to identify the changes in chemistry so that we can identify whether the change is a chemical change or no. And then we study about those chemical changes. Before that, we are going to learn a lot of other changes around us that happened because we need to term them. Every time we term them, whether that change is X, Y, Z, whatever. So that terminologies are very important. So we are going to do those terminologies in this next few minutes. Okay. So we'll go to our first slide. So if supposing I tell you to define what is a change. Okay. What are changes? Please define what is a change. So like I said, you all will come up with various examples around you. Some of the examples are given out here that could be breaking a glass, freezing a popsicle, making ice creams, splitting the milk. If supposing say that the milk has gone sour, you split the milk. That we did it with the lemon. I told you all to split the milk so that the milk gets split into solids and the water content so that you can then filter it, you can sieve it. Then you're mowing the grass, slicing bread, roasting marshmallows, breaking an egg.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Breaking the egg, exploding fireworks, then mixing Kool-Aid packets with water, squeezing an orange for a juice, evaporating water, burning a toast. Even before burning a toast, even making a toast, that could also be a change. Burning wood, popping popcorn, bleaching the hair, and so on. So all these, and last but not the least, melting the chocolate. So these all are changes. So if I am to define a change, what would I define the change as? I would say that something that was not there before, some condition that was not there before, but has now occurred, would be defined as a change. Okay. So this is what I can define a change is, right? Now we'll go to the next slide. Okay. So the first change that we're going to talk about is temporary change or a permanent change. Whenever I define, I say temporary change, I mean that change will not remain for a long time. Okay. That change will stay for a very short time. So, for example, you have wet sand will become dry sand very fast because it is in the sun. It will become dry very, very fast.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, I cannot see the next slide.
You cannot see temporary and permanent change?
Yes, ma'am.
I can see it.
Ma'am, I have...
Ma'am, but I can only see the changes slide.
Then please leave the meet and then rejoin. Some trouble with your internet. Okay, so now we have got temporary change, permanent change, a change that will not stay for a very long time. That change is called temporary change. Okay, a permanent is something that will remain forever. You have made it, it is going to happen. For example, growing up. Growing up is a permanent change. You can't say that now the child is grown
up. Your voice is cutting a little.
Into a teenager, he's going to go back in child baby stage. That okay.
Excuse me, ma'am.
My yes.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Okay. Okay, wait. I'll leave again and I'll rejoin again. Okay, now is my voice better?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we're talking about temporary and permanent change. A temporary change is which can be reversed back to its original form or which is staying for a very short period of time. So that is what we call it as a temporary change. What is a permanent change? A permanent change is the one that will remain forever. I just gave the example of a child growing up. If a child has grown up from a small baby, he has become into a teenager. Now from the teenager, I ask him, please go back and become into a child again. That is not possible. Okay. You have made a chapati. You will say that, okay, now I want to make the dough again from the chapati. No, it's not possible. Okay, so whenever I say temporary, it means it will not stay for a very long time. It will go back to the way it was. And a permanent change is which will remain forever, whatever the change has taken place. It will not be able to reverse back the change. Okay, so this is what is a temporary and a permanent change. A few examples given of the temporary and of the permanent change is one is drying, right? Drying of clothes. The clothes were wet. Okay, first the clothes were dry. I kept it for washing. So the clothes became wet. Now I want it to become again dry. So I've kept it in the sun. So again, it has now gone dry. Correct. So this is what we call as a temporary change. Permanent change, here given example is baking. Baking is a permanent change. Growing of a plant from a seed is a permanent change. Okay. So we'll go to the next change. Okay. Some changes are slow and some changes are fast. Okay, so the changes which take a long time to take place would be a slow change. So rusting of iron is a slow change. It will not happen that the rust will develop, you know, within minutes. It will take hours. Sometimes it takes even days also. So rusting is going to be a slow change. Even germination or growing of living beings is going to be a slow change. What is going to be a fast change? That happen instantly. So all the fireworks, they all happen instantly. Bursting of balloons, burning of papers, all these are very, very fast changes. They happen immediately. The minute you bring about whatever reaction you want to carry out, that change is going to take place. Okay, so we have got slow change and we have got fast change. Next. Now we have got another word that we use, reversible and irreversible. When I say reversible, I mean change can be reversed back by removing the cause of the change. For example, water, I had kept it in the freezer to make it into ice. The cause for the change was to give it cooling. Now I've removed the cooling. Now I've put it again in the environment. The ice possible change.
Your voice is breaking.
Keep it outside for a very long time. It'll melt.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Chocolate, you keep it outside.
Anita, your voice is breaking actually. It's not clearly audible.
Okay, I'll have to change my place then. 2 minutes, I'll rejoin back.
Ma'am, till now we have discovered three types of changes, right? Temporary, permanent, slow, fast, reversible, and irreversible. Was there any other change till now?
We will be doing further. Till now we have seen these three categories. We'll be studying further different types of changes as well.
Ma'am, till further, can you teach?
No, then ma'am will, and the link will be broken. So we'll wait for her to join. Okay?
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am is steam on a glass temporary change?
Steam on a glass, that is condensation.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that is a temporary change, right? It is not a permanent thing. Once you have condensation or water vapor bubbles on the glass, do they remain there permanently?
No, ma'am.
No, they don't, right? So Farida ma'am is here now. She'll take over.
Okay. So chocolate melting is a reversible change. That melted chocolate, if I put it back into its molds, it will again become into chocolate. So we'll say it is a reversible change. There are some changes which cannot be bought whatever you do. So those changes are irreversible change. So kind of way you can say, you can compare reversible, irreversible to temporary and permanent change. Okay, a temporary change is what you call it to be a reversible change, and a permanent change is to the irreversible change. You cannot bring it back. So like I said, the dough that you have made it into bread, now if you say that the bread you want to make it back into the original dough, not possible. Growing up, if you want the man to become again into a child, not possible to reverse it back. Okay, so such things are which are irreversible changes. So we did permanent, temporary, we did slow, fast, and we did reversible and irreversible change.
Ma'am, I have a question. Let's say I evaporated water from a salt water mixture. Then would that be a reversible or irreversible change?
It is a reversible change, no? Because you got back the contents that were. You got water and salt in its original form without any changes. The composition of water and salt remain the same chemically. Yes. Okay, chalo, next. Now we've got periodic and non-periodic changes. Periodic changes are those changes that happen after a regular interval of time. For example, your rising of the sun, rising of the moon, that entire changes are going to be periodic. They happen after a certain time period. So if I say that my sun is going to come up after 24 hours once it has set down. Means if supposing at 6 o'clock it has risen, again after 24 hours at 6 o'clock in the morning, it is again going to rise up. That is going to be a periodic change. Okay. What is a non-periodic change? Which don't repeat themselves at any interval. For example, all the natural phenomena like earthquakes, cyclones, volcanic eruptions, those all will be non-periodic changes. Okay, in periodic changes, example would be like I gave you sun rising, moon rising, then the phases of the moon, heartbeat is also periodic change until and unless the person is living. Once the person heart stops beating, it would become a permanent change forever, right? The moving of the pendulum, the moving of the hand clocks, the hands of the clock, those all are periodic changes. Okay, next. Now we've got desirable change and we've got undesirable change. What are desirable changes? The changes that we want to take place. So for example, we want the fruits to ripe up so that we can eat it. The changes that we want to take place are called as desirable changes. We want the seed to grow so that it can become into a plant so that we can consume it, or then the plant will bear fruits that we can use, or the plants will bear flowers that we can use, etc. So those changes would be called as desirable changes. What are undesirable changes? The changes that we don't want to happen. We don't want the fruit ripening to happen so much that it starts to rot. We don't want that rotting of food. Okay. We don't want rusting of iron. We don't want COVID to happen again and again. So right now, the COVID pandemic is an undesirable change that has taken place. So this is called as an undesirable change. Okay. Desirable and undesirable changes. Okay. Next. Now we come to the main topic. We are going to do two types of changes. One will be a physical change and one will be a chemical change. When I refer to a physical change, I meant that there is no chemical reaction taking place out there. Whatever change is happening only physically. So for example, I take a paper and I am tearing it into pieces. By tearing it in pieces, have I changed the chemical composition of it? No. Okay. I prefer if nobody gives me comments in between, it's fine. Okay. Yeah. So if I take a paper and if I burn it, what will happen? The chemical composition will change. Burning will change the composition of the paper, that will not be a physical change. So whenever a change that has taken place, it's going to change the matter from one form to the other. Then I mean it is a physical change. Means the matter which was will look totally different than what it was before. Okay. A change that may change the size or the shape of the object or even the color, but it does not change the composition. Such a change is called as a physical change. Okay. Here the example is given making of a orange juice. You take the orange that was round, nice and round. Okay, what did you do? You're cutting it into half, you're putting it into a juicer, you're removing the juice from it. The minute you're removing juice from it, what are you doing? First of all, it was solid form. Now you have made it into liquid form. So it has gone from one form to the other, one state to the other. Okay. But in making the juice, did the chemical composition of the orange juice change? No. So it will be a physical change. Okay. So any change that will affect the chemical composition would be a chemical change. But the one that is not affecting the chemical composition, then I say that is a physical change. Okay. We'll see a few examples of it. Next slide. See, cutting of paper, physical change. By cutting, you're not changing the composition of the material. Okay. Smashing potatoes, you're not changing the potato's composition. Painting a wall. Whatever paint was there, you just put it on the wall. Here, no chemical reaction taking place. Breaking glass. Glass was as it is, the whole piece. It has broken down into pieces. That's it. Melting marshmallows. The marshmallows have melted. Just melted. So they've gone from solid state to liquid state. That's it. You're not. When I say burning marshmallows, it will become a chemical change. But when I'm just melting them, they're just going to be a physical change. Clay modeling. Whatever with clay you all are making, all the different shapes, you tell that to be as a physical change. Freezing, melting, boiling, all those states of matter. All those states of matter are going to be physical change. Okay. Thawing of meat. Thawing is a word that we use when anything is kept in the freezer for a very long time and then you want to suddenly get it back to the room temperature. That process is called as thawing. Okay. So if something is kept in the freezer for a very long time, you bring it outside and you get it back to the room temperature, nothing is going to happen to it, to the chemical composition of it. So you say it is a physical change. So these all are physical changes. Next. Now we say, what is a chemical change? A chemical change is a change because of which totally the substance properties are going to change. Everything chemical composition is going to change. And it is going to result into a new substance. This is a very important point. It is changing into a new substance. A new substance is being formed. So that is when I say that it is a chemical change. And the chemical changes are always permanent in nature. You cannot really get back the original form that was. Okay. So you get a new substance and the change is permanent. For example, baking of cake. In the baking of cake, what do? You take your batter, you put it into the oven. After putting it into the oven, you are waiting for it to get hardened. And whatever reaction takes place inside, because of the you've added baking soda, that baking soda is releasing carbon dioxide gas. gas, that carbon dioxide gas causes the batter to rise up. The minute the batter rises up, your cake becomes nice and firm. Okay, so here a chemical reaction took place. The batter became into a cake. Yes, so all the cooking process that you do, the entire cooking processes that we do, all of those are chemical change. The food that we eat right from our mouth, the enzymes start breaking it. It goes into the stomach, all the enzymes and all the acids start reacting on it. All this happens, and so we say it is a chemical change. Okay? So all the chemical changes are taking place while making food, while eating food, all those are chemical changes. Okay? Because a new substance is being formed. In the process, a new substance is being formed. So we say
I think Farida ma'am has left the group. No, she's there.
Hello?
Yeah, Farida.
Yeah. I just explained, it was audible, no? About chemical changes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I explained everything. Y'all heard when I said, no, about eating food also.
Yes, ma'am.
No, it wasn't audible from the digestion portion.
Acha. Okay. So digestion is also a chemical change. The food that we eat right from the mouth is getting broken down by enzymes, and those enzymes are breaking the hard complex material food into easy simple material that our food is, that can be passed into our blood, and so we say that it is a chemical process because it is becoming into a new material. So we say it is a chemical change. Okay. We'll go to the next slide. So there are examples of chemical changes given inside it. So burning. So remember, like I told you all, burning is nothing but combustion, that is nothing but oxidation. So whenever I refer to anything burning, it is going to be a chemical change. All the burning is going to be a chemical change. The wood that I burned has become into ash and smoke. That is a new material. That's a new substance. So I say it is a chemical change. Okay. Then we have got iron rusting. The rusting of iron is also a chemical change. I told you all, melting of marshmallow is a physical change. But if I burn the marshmallows, it becomes a chemical change. Rotting of food, any type of rotting of food is going to become a chemical change. Toasting of bread, making of chapatis, all of those are chemical changes. Okay. Living beings growing up is also a chemical change. Lot of chemical changes are taking place in our entire body. Right from when it was baby to right when it became a teenager, then it becomes old. All of those are chemical changes. So next slide. So here we are completing.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking a lot.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking. Ma'am, I have a doubt. So, is like rotting banana?
I don't banana rotting.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
I don't know what is the problem today. Now is it breaking?
No, ma'am.
Now is it breaking? Okay. Rotting of banana, how can it be a period? How can you classify it into that change? Periodic or non-periodic? You can put it into desirable and undesirable. You can put it into permanent or temporary. You can't put it into periodic or non-periodic. If you want to put it into non-periodic, it will be a non-periodic change. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else? Any more questions based on changes?
Ma'am, I have.
Ma'am, can you speak a little loud?
Ma'am, I did not understand desirable and undesirable change.
Desirable change is something that you want to happen. You want to go out, you want to go and meet your friends, you want to go to the garden is a desirable change. You want it to happen. You want the pandemic COVID to just completely end. It is a desirable change. The pandemic COVID not ending for the last 3 months is an undesirable change. Some things that you don't want. So the things that you want would be a desirable change. The things that you don't want to happen would be an undesirable change.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Any more questions related to these changes, anyone?
No, ma'am. All are clear.
All clear? Voice is also clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now we finish with the changes. Now we'll go to the next part of it. Next presentation. Okay. Now, like we said, physical change, chemical change. Physical change is not making the substance change into a new material. Chemical change is making the substance change into a new material. So now what to do? How to identify those chemical changes? So for us to identify those chemical changes, there are certain signs that we have identified. That we know that if these signs are there, probably there could be a chemical reaction. Why is it so? Because see, whatever we are saying changing about the chemical structure will change inside. Okay? You can't see the material and say that yes, the chemical change has taken place. For example, I'm talking about there is dough, and that dough is now being baked into bread. By looking at the bread, you can't say that a chemical change has taken place, okay? Because you can't come to know that, okay, the chemical composition of the dough was X, Y, Z, and now it has become 1, 2, 3. Okay, you can't just look at it and identify. You'll have to go into the molecular structure of it. You'll have to go into the studies of it. So for us to identify by our common senses, the 5 senses that we have got, we've got senses like eyes to see, nose to smell, hearing by ears, tasting in certain cases, not with chemistry though, and touching with hand. Okay, So by these five senses, we want to identify whether a chemical change has taken place or no. So there are certain signs that tell us that, okay, there could be a chemical change that may have taken place. Okay. So we are going to identify those. There are five of them. We're going to identify which five of them are there. And we're going to see examples in each one of them. Okay. So we'll go to the first one. So these are the five changes of chemical reaction. First is production of gas. Any kind of gas being produced anywhere would be a sign of a chemical change. Production of light. If there is light that is being produced somewhere, then it is a chemical change. Permanent color change. The color has changed completely. Now you can't get it back to your original form. Formation of a precipitate. What is a precipitate? I'll come to it when we come to that slide. And the last is a temperature change. The temperature is going to become high or the temperature is going to become low. Then you say it is a temperature change. Okay. So these are the five changes and we're going to see into detail each one of them. So first one is production of gas. Okay. If you see gas bubbles anywhere that has come, that is occurring, then you say that there is a chemical change happening. Okay, here there's water and in that water I have put dry ice. When that water reacted with dry ice, it was producing lots of bubbles. Those bubbles are a reaction, chemical reaction, and we can identify that a chemical reaction has taken place out there. Okay, that is what we say is a chemical change, production of gas.
Ma'am, can you tell us the formula, like dry ice is CO, and water is H2O, so what happens then?
Okay, here I'm not going to give you the formula exactly what is happening. In the next slide, I'm going to give you the formula. Okay.
Ma'am, is soap water also a chemical change?
What?
Ma'am, soap water?
Soap water, no. Soap water is not a chemical change.
Okay, ma'am.
Soap water is not a chemical. It is just the soap was in solid form. When you kept it in liquid, it becomes bubbles can be formed, soapy, but it is not a chemical change. It is a physical change.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, next. Next slide. So,
ma'am, I have a doubt.
Ha, tell.
Ma'am, when we wash copper utensils with Ma'am, Pitambari, if you wash copper utensils with it, does the copper get oxidized?
Wash it.
Yes, ma'am.
Copper vessels, ma'am? Washing of copper vessels would not be a chemical change.
Ma'am?
It's a physical change, no?
Ma'am?
How can it be a... Yes.
And will the chemical formula be CH2O3?
For what?
For this.
No. This, I really don't know what the chemical reaction is. I will let you all know. I'll find out and I'll let you all know. Because normally when we mix... when we're making coke, what do we do is we add carbon dioxide gas to it. So H2O plus CO2 becomes H2CO3. That is the formula for making Pepsi, Coke or whatever. But this is a different reaction. This is, you know, when you take hot water and in hot water you make dry ice, it becomes like a bomb. It becomes like a small bomb kind of a thing. So this reaction is going to be different, what is shown out here. Okay, so we'll go to the next slide. The next slide is what the reaction is, okay? Now we are going to send you a list of activities that you can do at your house, okay? You can do this activity in your house. You can take a small glass. In that small glass, if you have vinegar at home, you can add vinegar. And in that vinegar, you can add one pinch of baking soda, okay? The minute you do that, you will see a bubble, continuously flow of bubbles coming out.
Mama did this experiment.
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. So what
ma'am is called elephant toothpaste.
This is not elephant toothpaste. Okay. This is something else. Okay. So what the actual reaction is, we'll go to the next slide. Once more, I hear anybody messaging, no, I am going to make the person out of the group. Okay, anybody messaging on the group, I'm going to put them out of the group. Seriously. Okay, so here the reaction is happening. We have got vinegar, that is the actual formula is CH3COOH. That is the formula CH3COOH, and we are reacting it with baking soda, that is NaHCO3. Now, can you see the formula on the left hand side, the reactants? Those reactants are now totally changing on the right side. Can you see what the formula is becoming? It is becoming CH3COONa plus H2O plus CO2. So totally the composition are changing. New substance is being formed. When I mean new substance, I don't mean that I'm creating something out of the blue, something new. No, new means what was not there and now I have made it there from that. So I have changed the left side composition and it has become to a composition which is on the right hand side. And in that process, what is being released? CO2 gas is being released. Because CO2 gas is being released, you can see those bubbles coming up. The actual word that we use for CO2 bubbles coming up is called as effervescence. Effervescence. So whenever there is effervescence, we say, that is a proper chemistry word that we use. Effervescence is what we observe in any reaction for production of gas. Okay. So the first sign of a chemical reaction is effervescence. Effervescence is what we are looking out for. Okay.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, where the gas bubbles formula is written CH3COONa, then ma'am, that OO, why is it not O2?
O2? What O2? Here you won't write CO2.
Yes, ma'am.
No, this is the way it is written. Why it is written? Because it is an organic compound. And this is the way you write it. When you'll go further to study, you'll come to know that why you write COO and you don't write O2 out there.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Next is production of light. Whenever due to some reaction, light is being produced, you say that it is a chemical process. Light, fire, burning, any of this thing that is happening, you say that there is chemical reaction that has taken place. Correct? So now the best example of production of light is in the firecrackers. The firecrackers is where you see continuously lights in let's say in your fulgaris, in your chakris, in your anars, in the rockets, you see lots and lots of light being produced. So you say that is a chemical reaction taking place. Okay. So this is what is going to be a chemical change, the production of light. Next slide. Here we do an experiment in the lab we take magnesium ribbon and we burn it. The minute you burn it, you will see a bright white color light being produced. That bright white color light was a indication that a chemical change has taken place. Okay, so you can see that such a bright light is being produced. You see such bright lights again in your fireworks. So it proves that we are showing you all that magnesium metal is being used in your firecrackers. You use magnesium material in your firecrackers. Okay, so production of light. First thing is production of gas, which you also called as effervescence. And production of light is also a sign of a chemical reaction. Okay, we'll go to the next slide so we can understand the chemistry of it. You see that magnesium formula is Mg. I am burning it, so I say I'm reacting it with O2. When I'm reacting it with O2, it is changing into MgO. So left hand side, I had two reactants, magnesium and oxygen. They both combined and they formed the product MgO. So new material is formed. So it is a chemical reaction. How do I identify the chemistry? I can't see the chemical formula. So I have to see for some signs, and the sign that I saw was light. So production of light is what I say is a chemical reaction. Now one question that comes to mind is, every day in the morning, night, we switch on our tube lights. Yes, we switch on the fans. Is that a physical change or is that a chemical change?
Ma'am, chemical change.
Ma'am, chemical change.
Okay. That's it? Only two people want to answer?
No, it's a physical change. It's a physical change.
Okay. Majority saying chemical. I heard one person saying physical.
Ma'am, it is a physical change because it can be reversed.
Yes, ma'am, it's a physical change.
Yes, ma'am, it's a physical change.
Ma'am, it can be a chemical change.
Oh. Ma'am, it's a physical change.
Ma'am, it is a physical change.
Okay. You first just said it is a chemical change. Now you're saying it is a physical change. Okay. So now let's go by your words. First, we say that it is a chemical change. If it was a chemical change, every time you switch it on and you switch it off, you would have to go and change the material of the light material. Correct? Every time you would have to go and you would have to change the things because chemicals will get over if there are chemicals out there. Correct? So whenever I do anything, I'm relating anything related to electricity, it is a physical change. The effects of electricity are all physical changes. They are not chemical changes. It's just flow of electrons. When electrons are flowing, that phenomenon is taking place. And when electrons are not flowing, that effect is not seen. Now your batteries, whenever the batteries is getting discharged. Yes, batteries getting discharged because you had used chemicals inside it. Those chemicals reacted and were producing electrons, and that was being used to produce effects of electricity. So effects of electricity is not a chemical change. It is a physical change. Okay? Yes, understood? So the light which I mean here and the light which we get in physical electricity is different. Okay, light, by light I mean fire, in any type of fire, any type of light that we can see because of a chemical change. Okay, so we did two changes, one is gas and one is light. We'll go to the next slide, next change. Okay, temperature change. Okay, very important, whenever you want to make bonds, whenever you want to break bonds, it will not happen on its own. That making and breaking of bond is not going to take place on its own. It's not that something just standing is going to react and is going to happen. No, there is going to be energy required for it to change. For that change, energy will be required. And the best form of energy that we can give is by heat. By heat. Okay. So, to break bonds or to make bonds, you require energy. So, what happens is that when this takes place, when this entire reaction takes place, either you say that energy is given out, or you say that energy is taken in. And in that case, the temperature of the material, whichever is there, is going to change. So if the temperature of the overall material is increasing, the temperature is increasing. So if supposing the reacting material was at, say, 10 degrees, okay, and now after the reaction has taken place, it has become to 20 degrees. So there is an increase in temperature. That increase in temperature means the reaction is an exothermic reaction. Exothermic. It is releasing the heat outside. If overall the temperature reduces down, if the temperature was 10 and it has now gone to become 5, if it has become 5, the whole temperature has gone down. So you say it is an endothermic. Exo is when heat is given out. Endo is when heat is taken inside. So these two conditions will tell you whether a reaction is taking place or no. Correct? So we'll see examples of it. Next slide. So the first example that you all are going to do is, you all are going to take two glasses. In those two glasses, you'll fill them half with normal tap water. Okay, you can fill them with normal tap water. Okay, feel the normal tap water with your hand. You remember we had done the activity of touch, temperature touch by hand. So you can feel the temperature of the normal tap water with your hand. Now you're going to add 6 to 7 spoons of salt into it. The minute you put salt into it and you start to dissolve it with a spoon, you will observe that the solution will become cooler. The solution becomes much, much cooler. So that is identifying that whatever reaction has taken place, it is absorbing the heat from the surroundings, and so the temperature has gone down. And because the temperature has gone down, you say it is an endothermic reaction. So for endothermic reaction, you are going to take a glass of water, half glass of water, in that you're going to put 6 to 7 spoons of salt, mix it, feel the water again. You will see that the water has become much, much cooler. So you say it is an endothermic reaction.
Ma'am, so can we use this to see if the water is pure or not? Like we can take pure water and tap water and see which is cooler, and maybe which is cooler, that is more pure.
Next slide. exothermic reaction. For an exothermic reaction, as you can see, the temperature is going up and up in the thermometer. Can you see the temperature is going up and up higher? So the temperature is rising. If the temperature is rising, I mean that the reaction is an exothermic reaction. It is releasing heat outside. So for that, what you all are going to do is, you all are going to take again that same half glass of water. In that half glass of water, you will put 6 to 7 spoons of detergent. 6 to 7 spoons of detergent, normal detergent we use in the house for washing clothes. You will observe that that solution will become now warm. Why it becomes warm? Because after the reaction, what happens is that the solution is releasing heat outside. So you say it is an exothermic reaction. Okay, so two reactions. If it's becoming cold, you say endothermic. If it is becoming hot, you say exothermic reaction. Very easy to identify. So temperature change means, if the temperature is becoming high, you say exothermic. If the temperature is becoming low, you say it is endothermic reaction.
Mom, can we use this to find out, can we use the endothermic experiment to find out if the water is impure or not?
Impure or no?
Mom, because if you put salt in the water, the water becomes cooler. So if we take pure water and tap water, we can find out which is pure. Can we do that experiment like that?
No, this is going to be for a certain time till the reaction is taking place. Once the reaction is taking place, you'll come to know that the reaction is taking place. Once the reaction is occurred, it'll come back to the normal room temperature within some time. It is during the reaction is taking place. We are not identifying here anything. What?
Mom?
Yes.
Mom, oxidation of wood will be an exothermic reaction.
Oxidation of? I can't hear you, I am.
It's because someone muted.
Actually, I am, your voice is breaking a lot. Please type your question.
Ma'am, I cannot hear you.
Because I'm not saying only anything. I'm waiting for Ayam to write his question down. Oxidation is an exothermic reaction. Yes, oxidation is an exothermic reaction. We just saw oxidation of magnesium. Magnesium, when it was reacting with oxygen, it released a lot of fire and heat also. So it is an oxidations are all mainly exothermic reactions. Okay, so first change we saw was production of gas. Second change we saw was production of light. And third change we saw was change in temperature. Temperature becoming high, temperature becoming low. Okay, now we'll go to the fourth sign of chemical reaction. Okay, so this is again, if something is cold, you say endothermic. If something is hot, you say it is an exothermic reaction. Next change. Okay. Permanent color change. If during a reaction, some color has changed permanently, then you call that to be as a chemical change. Now for that, please don't tell me when I take a paint and I put it on the walls, is that a chemical change? No. You're just taking the paint and you're just putting it on the walls. Okay. And it is just solidifying after some time. Means you say that it is drying up. So it is only a physical change. Here, when I mean a chemical change is when I'm taking certain chemicals, I'm reacting those two chemicals, and then the product that was formed is a totally new color. So if supposing on the left side you see that there is yellow and transparent solutions, if I'm mixing both of those together, then it is becoming into a reddish color solution. The solution is becoming reddish color. So this is what I say a color change. So a color change is what will identify whether a chemical change has taken place or no. Another example of chemical change in forms of color would be your ripening of fruits. The raw fruits are becoming into ripe fruits. So if the raw fruits are becoming into ripe fruits, the kachi keri which was there was green in color. Now it has become into yellowish or orangish in color. And so you say that that color change has brought about. So ripening of fruits is a chemical change. We go further to it. If you don't consume that mango and after some time you observe, after some days, that that yellow, that orange in color has now become black color. So again, color change happened, black color. So that is again a chemical change. Okay, so ripening of fruits, rotting of fruits, all of those are chemical changes. Correct? On the right side, you can see another picture. In that picture, you can see we have used some wire. And that wire, we are reacting it with a transparent solution. The minute I'm doing that, the color of the solution is changing to blue color. So this is a chemical change. Okay. You're mixing white paint with blue paint. Oh, sorry, you're mixing white paint with black paint. It is becoming gray color. No, that is not a chemical change. That is just a physical change. Okay. Those are not chemical changes. Okay. Those are just physical change. Here, the chemistry is changing. If I go to study the chemistry of these substances, they're going to change. And so that is why I say that it is a sign of a chemical reaction occurring. Okay. We'll go to the next slide for an example. So we all know about Statue of Liberty. Okay. Statue of Liberty was actually gifted to US by a country, that is France, in somewhere around 1886. When it was gifted, it was, as you can see the color, it was reddish, goldenish color. So actually, it was made out of copper. Now, you've seen copper wires, how they are, what is the color of the copper wire is. So why is it today that you can see the Statue of Liberty into green color? Why is it that you can see that green in color?
Some oxidation.
Yes, correct. Next slide. So this is what happened. The copper was oxidized in presence of the water vapor and the carbon dioxide in the air. So all the water vapor, carbon dioxide and the oxygen, all of that reacted with the copper that the Statue of Liberty was made of. And it became into copper hydroxide plus copper carbonate. And copper carbonate is what is actually green in color. Okay. So what we see today, the Statue of Liberty is not copper, it is copper carbonate. Probably only on the outside. I don't know if we scratch it inside, the layer can be removed, outer layer, and inside again there could be a normal copper layer, but again after a certain time it will again get oxidized. What was the solution for us? What was the solution to do for not getting it oxidized? Anyone give me answer?
Ma'am, we could have covered it up.
You could have?
Ma'am, we could have covered it up with some sort of thing.
Ma'am, we could have painted it.
painted. Okay.
Ma'am, we could have used some other material.
What other material?
Ma'am, maybe bronze.
So what did you make out of it? What are you making? What are you doing to it?
Ma'am, we're making it non-rustable.
So what is it that you're making? We discussed it last time. Which you all are continuously asking me questions about.
Ma'am, alloy.
Yes, you could have formed an alloy of copper, which would have looked like copper, but it would not have rusted.
Ma'am, we could have used an oxygen inert material and coated it.
What material?
Ma'am, oxygen inert material.
Oxygen inert material and coated it. Okay, all those galvanizing and all those are there, but the best form of it would be to use an alloy. Probably at that time an alloy would have been used. The shine would have been there as of copper only. It would look like copper, but it would not have eroded. It would not have corroded. It would not have rusted. Okay, so this is a permanent color change, an example of a permanent color change. Next. Now we come to the last form of it, and that is called as a precipitate. Okay. Now what happens in a precipitate is, if supposing I've taken two solutions and I've reacted them together, what will happen is that they are forming a product. So let's say I've taken reactant A, I've taken reactant B. Both those reactants are reacting and forming product C and product D. Okay. If those two products C and D are not miscible with each other, means what happens? They are immiscible. They are not reacting with each other. Then what will happen is, they are not mixing with each other. Then what you can see is a precipitate. What you will be able to see is that a lump of some solid being formed. So here you can see all the different lumps, the white color, the cream color, the yellow color lump. So all these lumps that are formed is what we are calling it as a precipitate. Okay. And those precipitates are normally, most of the cases, they are denser, they are heavier. So they will fall down. Okay. If they are lighter, they may float up. If they are denser, they will fall down. Okay. So what formation of a precipitate is a sign of a chemical reaction means the precipitate that was formed because of the reaction between the both the reactants. Okay. We've got one example in the next slide.
So, Mama, if we mix the two reactants, then in the middle, what type of solid will be made? It is known as the precipitate.
Yes. Here you can see I am reacting sodium hydroxide with silver nitrate. Can you see? Sodium hydroxide was transparent. The minute in my dropper, I'm adding another transparent material. The minute that is happening, both of them are reacting and forming some precipitate. You can see how the precipitate is formed. Correct? So,
yes, ma'am.
You can see the reaction next slide. NaOH and silver nitrate is what the two materials were, the reactant. Both of them were transparent, correct? Now the minute they both reacted together, two transparent materials, they became into browny precipitate. That was the precipitate of AgOH. So the chemical composition changed, it became NaNO3 and AgOH, correct? And that AgOH was solid, so it became into a precipitate, the muddy brown precipitate that we can see. Okay. So formation of precipitate is also an indicator of a chemical reaction. So five chemical reactions, five signs of a chemical reaction. First one that we saw was production of gas. Second one we saw was production of light. Third one we saw change in temperature. Fourth one we saw was color change, a permanent color change. And the fifth one that we saw was formation of a precipitate. So five things that will identify whether a chemical reaction has taken place or not. Okay. So next slide. So we are done with this presentation today. So we discussed about changes and we discussed about signs of chemical changes, okay? Because we are going to study about chemistry. So we need to identify the chemical changes that are there. So anyone having any doubts related to this topic?
No doubts, ma'am.
Or previous topic?
No.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
So NaOH was a liquid, AgNO3 was a liquid, okay? When both of them are reacting, they are forming a new substance. So the new substance that they are forming is NaNO3 and AgOH. Now in that NaNO3 and AgOH, NaNO3 is in the liquid form. But AgOH is in the solid form. So because it was in the solid form, it formed into a precipitate. And that is what we can see.
So AgOH is the precipitate and NaNO3 is
the liquid.
Liquid.
Yes, the liquid.
No, no doubt.
Okay. Anyone?
No, ma'am.
Yes. No doubts, you'll have understood everything today.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yes, so are you referring to your reference books? Are you referring to the reference books that we have given
yes,
to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes, please do refer.